That a deal to save Bury collapsed. Expulsion from the Football League now looks likely.
For it to come to this, it's just heartbreaking.
I'm just gutted, but I don't know what to say.
We're also live at Bolton Wanderers, where the future of the club there also hangs in the balance.
And I'm Annabelle Tiffin. Also in tonight's programme, police investigating the murder of a teaching assistant release pictures of a suspect. The recent series of earth tremors, could they spell the end of fracking in Lancashire? And as a new film about L.S. Lowry and his mother premieres in Salford, we'll be live on the red carpet with the stars.
Well, what a change in mood here today. This morning, fans gathered here full of confidence that a deal announced on Friday would go ahead and their future would be secured. And then this afternoon, news that that deal had collapsed. A statement from the Football League saying the EFL has been informed that C&N Sporting Risk will no longer be pursuing their interest in Bury FC. The league continues to be in discussions with Bury FC and will provide a further update as appropriate. And now some late news for you. We hear that two new bidders have come onto the scene, one of whom we believe is already in talks with the Football League about taking over this club. Ian Haslam has been here throughout the day. What do you make of it all?
It's been a very strange day and a very disappointing day in many respects. But let's go through this again. Bury were told on Saturday lunchtime, Stuart, that unless the sale of the club was 99% complete or thereabouts by 5 o'clock today, they'd be expelled from the Football League. Now, clearly, that ship has sailed some time ago. But tonight, over the past couple of hours, there is some potentially good news for Bury fans to at least cling on to as we await official word from the English Football League. BBC Radio Manchester's Mike Miney, who's been breaking Bury stories left, right and centre over the past week or so, has told me in the last few moments that there are a couple of interested parties, one potential, one definite, and that definite buyer has gone directly to the EFL with proof of funds. The question is it all too little too late at this stage?
And what a turnaround for these fans who were expecting to see their first game of the season on Saturday.
Yeah, they turned up on mass this morning, hundreds of them. We were here since first thing to clean the ground, spruce it up against for the match against Doncaster Rovers that they were hoping would go ahead. But never has a football match seemed further away than that one does at this current moment in time. 10 o'clock this morning, and for Bury's future, the clock was ticking. But where there was hope, there were hundreds of fans doing all they could to help their football club.
This is what Bury fans are, and I mean, it's not just Bury fans here today. We've Blackpool fans, Bolton fans, Manchester City fans, Huddersfield fans. Fans are really, really upset the way the league is run and the governance, but they're all getting together.
Whether mopping floors or cleaning seats, the aim was to get Gig Lane gleaming again ahead of a long-awaited first match of the season.
They've all got together and they're doing what they can do, aren't they? You know, so it's really good.
Fantastic.
Isn't it? Yeah. Working as a team.
Communities, you know, got together and that's what they need.
As the waiting game continued, things were looking positive. If the club could be sold by 5 o'clock, expulsion from the Football League could be avoided.
Well, you need to be honest with the fans. It's not over the line. There's still quite a lot of obstacles and barriers to overcome. But yes, I'm optimistic and hopeful. I believe the organisation that wants to run this football club are good people who want to do the right thing. I believe the English Football League are doing everything in their power to make it happen.
Meanwhile, all the club's few remaining staff could do was, like the fans, wait and hope.
What does it feel like looking at all these people here that have turned out today?
No, it's very emotional. Seeing this number of people here, we put the call out, we expected some to come down. Not like this. This is just overwhelming. What is happening with the Football League and the chairman and the new prospective owners, that's out of our hands. We can't affect that. That's all down to them. But what we can do is get a stadium ready for a game of football.
As the afternoon wore on, more camaraderie. Bolton mascot Lofty the Lion joined his Bury counterparts with the message, standing together. But then came the news fans had been dreading. C&N Sporting Risk had ended their interest in the club.
I'm just gutted, but I don't know what to say. And I've got to tell my son, who's in Spain at the moment, he's 8 years old, and he's thrown all away his city kits and stuff and said he wants to support Bury. And And I've got to break the news. I just thought it was a formality, everything was going through.
For it to come to this, it's just heartbreaking.
How long have you been coming to this club for?
About 25 years.
And what does it mean to you?
It means everything.
I genuinely believe that we'll be back here on Saturday. It's not going to happen, is it? It's never going to happen again.
Meanwhile, as fans tried to digest the news, Bury's controversial owner spoke to BBC Radio Manchester.
Everyone who's come to the table looks at the debt he's in that's historic from Stuart Day's era, and the deal's collapsed. Seeing these lads come forward, they wanted to get the deal done, tried to get a deal done on the stadium, sadly they couldn't do, and felt that without a stadium they couldn't continue.
Well, that's the current owner, Steve Dale, and I can tell you that while you were watching that, he's told us the latest news, which is that there are, he says, three potential bidders now talking to the league, one of whom is a former owner of Gateshead FC. But it's worth a note of caution here. Just listen to what CNN Sporting Risk had to say about why they pulled out. They talk about complexities of a deal. In a statement, they say that that referred to systemic failures over a number of years. In other words, it sounds like they took a good look at the books and they didn't like what they saw. John Wiggins is a lifelong Bury supporter, lives not far from the ground. What do you make of it all?
To be honest, if the news is true, well, the news is true that they've pulled out, it's devastating, just not for the fans of Bury, but the entire community of Bury, really. Because it affects so many people, just not, obviously, not the Bury fans, but the businesses around the local area, and it just...
And this morning, you were all thinking you had a match to look forward to on Saturday.
Yes, 100%. And it showed with the 300 people that came down to tidy it all up.
We are hearing of three potential other bidders, but you've been hearing this kind of thing for so long now. How much confidence can you have?
I take it with a pinch of salt at this moment in time now, because it's happened like this. But, you know, we just, as Bury fans and probably Bolton fans as well, we just want to know if the football authorities are going to bring Dale and Anderson to justice, really.
Bury FC have put out a statement tonight urging fans not to attempt to break into to the ground here at Gig Lane to steal souvenirs. It's an extraordinary situation.
It is, and to be honest, I suppose some fans would probably want to do that, but to be honest, majority of us Bury fans are very respectful of the ground because it holds so big part of our lives to our heart, really. So nothing, I don't think anything like that will happen.
Let's hope not. John, thank you very much for talking to us. Let's hope things work out here. That's the latest in Bury. As you can imagine, as a Bolton fan, I've had half an ear on what's been happening a few miles away in Bolton. Let's get the latest on that now. Here's Annabelle.
Yeah. Indeed, Stuart. Thanks very much from Bury there. As Stuart mentioned, the fate of Bolton Wanderers still hangs in the balance tonight as well. Bolton has been a member of the Football League for 145 years, but administrators could start closing the club tomorrow. Well, our reporter Peter Marshall has been there all day. He's still there for us now. And so, Peter, what is the latest there in Bolton?
Well, Annabelle, you can see the Nat Lofthouse statue behind me, a famous old player of this famous old club. It would have been his 94th birthday today if he was still alive. It's hard to imagine what he might make of the crisis that's engulfed his club. Now, the 5 o'clock deadline came and went. That was set by the English Football League. We heard then just a short statement from the club that said this: discussions are ongoing with all parties. A further statement will be issued later this evening. So as it stands, we don't know. We're unsure if a deal for new owners has been secured. We don't know if the EFL will move to expel Bolton Wanderers from the Football League. And we don't know if the administrators will start to wind up the club because there's simply no money left. All in all, a bad day for Bolton Wanderers supporters.
Take these strawberry idiots! Pound a pony!
Bright and early, they were doing their best to remain upbeat at Bolton Market. But it wasn't easy. Steve Scarborough is Bolton born and bred, Bolton Wanderers through and through.
As far as I'm concerned, where I'm stood here now, it's gone Bolton Wanderers. And that is, I'd never thought I'd say that in my lifetime. And how am I going to, how can I encourage my grandchildren to follow Bolton Wanderers when you're treated like this?
At the Cozy Cafe, the mood is little better. The deal everyone hoped would secure new owners fell through on Saturday morning, leading to today's frantic last-minute efforts to resolve the crisis.
It's our club, it's nobody else's, and we're the ones that's doing all the suffering as per normal. Not the first time. I can remember going around with a bucket at Burnden Park in the 80s, early 80s, Division 4. No doubt we might even end up below that, but so be it.
That'll be the end of a, you know, institution really in this area, especially, you know, generations of football fans who've been to Burnham Park and then to the Reebok Stadium. When our three sons, they're all Bolton fans. So they just I don't know what we do.
It's hard to imagine what Nat Lofthouse, the Lion of Vienna, would make of the crisis at his famous old club. Administrators had warned that failure to secure a deal or offer reasons for an extension to the English Football League's 5pm deadline could see the process of winding up the club start as soon as tomorrow.
How important has it been to you and your family?
I've been a season ticket holder for 25 years, since I was 12 years old, like my daughter now.
So, to the very thought of it going out of the Football League,
it's just heartbreaking.
It's the heartbeat of the community. It's my family. I come here with my family to watch football. It's heartbreaking.
The town's football club is about far more than just banter. If Wanderers fold, so do 150 jobs and the business it brings into this community.
If you travel anywhere and say, and people ask you where you come from and you say Bolton, they will say, oh, Bolton Wanderers. So I think that indicates really how important the name recognition is. It puts this town on the international map.
Only one thing remains certain. Today will live long in the memories of Bolton Wanderers supporters.
Well, Bolton Wanderers are founder members of the Football League. They're four-time winners of the FA Cup. It's a club with a proud history. So how has it found itself in this crisis? Well, Abby Jones has been trying to find out.
No Roman emperor returning with his army from a successful campaign ever had such a welcome.
Bolton's 1958 FA Cup win brought the town streets to a standstill. The team received as conquering heroes after defeating a makeshift Manchester United. It was their fourth cup win. The first in 1923 attracted record crowds.
For Boltonians, it became a bit of a regular sight, obviously, seeing every sort of two or three years or so.
This scrapbook belonging to Bolton captain Jimmy Seddon features unseen photos of the side's 1929 Cup win, the Wanderers becoming one of the oldest and most successful clubs to be reckoned with.
They were one of the most successful, one of the leading clubs in English professional football. They'd, from their early origins as a church side, become very successful. They won the FA Cup three times in a decade, which was almost unprecedented at that time. They played at the very first Foot Cup final at Wembley, so that in itself makes them part of English football history.
Only 20 years ago, Bolton were playing top-flight football in the Premier League, finishing in the top eight for four successive seasons. There was European success, reaching the last 16 of the UEFA Cup, but then came relegation in 2012. Financial woes followed, along with protests from the fans against controversial owner Ken Anderson. The Trotters' troubles continued to grow. In April, they were relegated from the Championship. Players went on strike over unpaid wages. In May, the club went into administration and had 12 points deducted. Finances were so dire, emergency food banks were set up for non-playing staff. Last week, manager Phil Parkinson and assistant Steve Parkin resigned. And on Saturday, the latest takeover bid collapsed. Last weekend's match against Ipswich was Bolton's lowest attendance for a league game in 22 years and their third successive 5-0 drubbing, proof of how far the club has fallen. For football fans looking back at Bolton's glory days today, will there be more history to add to these display cases? Or is the final chapter already written? Abby Jones, BBC North West Tonight.
Well, the latest that I can tell you is that tonight we're hearing that there are reasons to be cautiously optimistic. Those talks involving all parties are still ongoing and we are expecting some sort of statement from the club later on this evening. If we get any developments, we'll bring them to you as soon as we get them. For now, back to you.
Peter, thanks very much indeed. And indeed, we'll be back with Stuart Flinders at Gig Lane for any updates there as well at the end of the programme. But in other news, the scene.
More now on the situation at Bury, which has had its membership of the English Football League withdrawn. Jane Dougal is with us now from the BBC Sports Centre. Jane, this is a big moment for Bury.
Yes, it's being described as one of the darkest days in the league's recent history. Those were the words of the executive chair of the English Football League, Debbie Jevons, after announcing that Bury Football Club are to be expelled from the league. The club had been given an extension until 5pm tonight to find a buyer or for their owner, Steve Dale, to prove that he had the financial means to keep the club going for the remainder of the season. That deadline passed. And the EFL board say they met earlier this evening. They say they had a long and detailed discussion about the future of Bury Football Club, and it was decided that Bury's membership of the EFL be withdrawn without a successful resolution. They've said in a statement that despite repeated requests to Bury's owner, Steve Dale, the necessary evidence in respect of how the club would meet its financial commitments was simply not provided. And as a result, they've said that the attentions will now turn to securing new ownership at the club. You might remember there had been a proposed sale with a company called C&N Sporting Risk Limited. And Steve Dale said that he had accepted their offer. However, that offer was withdrawn after C&N Sporting Risk did their due diligence. They decided not to pursue their interest in Bury. So the EFL are saying, having fully considered all available options, including a number of late expressions of interest to the club, the EFL board unanimously determined, they say with enormous regret, that Bury's membership be withdrawn. They say that there could be no further suspensions to the fixture list because so far this season, Bury have not played a single match. If you remember, there's been reports that staff haven't been paid, players haven't been paid, ongoing concerns as well about the integrity of the competition. That was a significant factor. I'm just going to read you a quote from Debbie Jevons, the executive chair of the EFL. She says, "Today is undoubtedly one of the darkest days in the league's recent history. The EFL has worked determinedly and tirelessly to avoid this outcome, and it is with a heavy heart that this situation has been forced upon us." Now, obviously, the fans are going to be the people at the heart of all of this. The fans are going to be the people who will be very upset. And the statement goes on to say, "I understand this will be a devastating time for Bury's players, staff, supporters and the wider community. There is no doubt today's news will be felt across the entire football family. No one wanted to be in this position, but following repeated missed deadlines, the suspension of five league fixtures, in addition to not receiving the evidence we required, and a possible takeover not materialising, the EFL board has been forced to take the most difficult of decisions." So Bury Football Club has been expelled from the English Football League. Now, as for Bolton Wanderers, we have news about that club as well. They were in a similar predicament. Their proposed buyer withdrew over the weekend. Well, the EFL have now said that they have 14 days in which to meet all outstanding problems financially and to resolve them. The EFL board said that they decided to lift the suspension on the notice of withdrawal that was issued as per the EFL's insolvency policy because the club had entered administration in May of this year. Now, the EFL have said also in a statement that despite further exchanges with the administrators over the course of the bank holiday weekend and right up until today's deadline of 5pm, a resolution to ongoing impasse in negotiations regarding a completion of sale at Bolton Wanderers has not yet been found. So 14 days for Bolton Wanderers to find some sort of solution. And again, I have a statement from Debbie Jevons, the EFL chair on Bolton Wanderers. She says, "Despite repeated assurances, we are extremely disappointed that we are not in a position to reach a successful resolution with the sale of Bolton Wanderers and have therefore taken the decision to lift the suspension on the notice of withdrawal. I again urge all parties to finalise the proposed takeover. The reality of this action is that there are now 14 days to secure the club's long-term future, and I sincerely hope we can find a way through these challenging circumstances for the benefit of all those who have an association with the club." So very difficult days ahead for both Bury and for Bolton Wanderers as well. Bury, it seems to be a more extreme situation. If they have been expelled, as they have been expelled from the league, it means that they can no longer operate as a professional club. It means that they will have to go to non-league football, start again, as it were. For Bolton Wanderers, they have 14 days in which to attempt to resolve this situation financially, to potentially find a buyer. But a very difficult day for the English Football League and a very dark day for football in general in Britain.
OK, Jane, thanks very much indeed for bringing us that update news that, of course, we have been waiting to hear. There is more online on the BBC Sports pages, and we'll be